Hello and welcome back to the Shark's World. Today's video is on a topic that I believe doesn't get covered enough, if at all. Many of you here understand the concept of a preconceived notion, or a stereotype when a certain animal comes to mind. Lions are kings of the jungle, proud and strong. Dolphins are playful, intelligent, and caring. Cats are independent, monkeys are almost as smart as us, and dogs are man's best friend. But what about when a shark comes to mind? Monster. Man-eater. Jaws. But why is this the case? Why are sharks still, to this day, considered monsters, when all evidence points to them being the opposite of that? From the numbers on the International Shark Attack file, to the thousands of clips of people swimming with sharks in the wild peacefully. Why is it that when anyone mentions going into the ocean, their number one fear is getting eaten by a shark? The answer to all these questions are the little details. The subtle things no one points out or talks about. And in this video, I'm going to explain this in three crucial parts: narrative, context, and finally, the numbers. This video might be a long one, but I promise there's a point to all of this, and it is worth your time. So let's not keep you waiting and dive right in. Grab you a cold drink, pull up a chair to the table, and let me show you why, when it comes to sharks' reputation, the little details matter. So, let's start with the first section, narrative. In one of my earliest videos titled, "There Are No Good Shark Movies," I showed this picture here of a gentleman's collection of shark movies. Looking at the picture, 90% of them all have the same cover, as far as I'm concerned. A cover trying to emulate Jaws. Why Jaws? Because Jaws was the biggest movie of its time, on a scale never seen before until Star Wars came in. From that point on, every shark movie made it its mission to try to catch that lightning in a bottle again. The problem with this is the narrative it sets. Imagine if you were given a multiple choice test, with the question being, what is a shark? And your only reference was this picture. The average person doesn't encounter sharks often, if at all, nor do they do extensive research on them. So, for most people, the movies are their only reference. There would only be one answer among the choices: Jaws. B, C, and D would be blank. This is part of why my quote on all of my platforms is, I'm here to give people another option on how to think about sharks. It's why I don't go see shark movies, watch Shark Week, or anything with imaging similar to that of Jaws, because to me, they're all the same and send the same message. To me, Jaws isn't a shark. It's a Hollywood monster. This isn't a shark. This is. This isn't a shark. This is. This, sure as shit, isn't a shark. This is. Something to keep an eye out for is whenever there is a story or piece of media about going into the ocean, see who is usually one of the bad guys. It's usually sharks, whether it's people or other animals involved. I've said it before, but I'll happily say it again. The concept of good and evil doesn't exist in the ocean. Dolphins and whales aren't heroes, nor do they save people from sharks. Sharks aren't villains. They don't seek out humans as food. Yet every piece of advertisement, marketing, and narrative presented to the average person shows sharks as villains. From something as simple as a kid's book saying, "Watch out for sharks in the ocean," to a symbol representing sharks simply being a set of jaws. The Pokemon Sharpedo being a water and dark type. The Destiny 2 Sparrow being named Blood in the Water. A movie called Bad Guys, with the shark being one of the main cast as a bad guy. And let's be clear, it's all done on purpose. Maybe not maliciously, but it is done for the sake of marketing. Again, because they're trying to catch that lightning in a bottle, and that's the only option given as far as what sharks are. But Sharktoz, shouldn't kids watch out for sharks in the ocean? And haven't sharks eaten people in the past? Yes to both of those. But here's the piece most people miss, and it segues into the next part of this video. Context. I always say that the internet is a blessing and a curse. We have access to more information than any conqueror, philosopher, or military general did in the past. And it's not close. Problem is, with so much information going around so fast, especially in the social media age, the critical context is either missed or not given at all. Let me give an example. People often say that they don't want to get eaten by sharks. I tell them that sharks don't eat people. Then they bring up the recent attacks in Egypt or the USS Indianapolis attack. Before I continue, let me state that those were truly tragic events, and my condolences goes to those affected by them. Back to the point, I then ask those people which or how many humans are they going to eat that night. Humans have eaten other humans in the past, as gruesome as that is. They then respond with something along the lines of, "Those were extreme events, or anomalies." And that, ladies and gentlemen, is my point. The Egypt and Indianapolis were extreme events. Extreme events as in, it's not the norm, or something that happens on a regular basis. But everyone always brings them up, clearly missing that context. People will show clips of a shark swimming up to them quickly as a mock charge, then backing off, or something along those lines. But people will miss the context that the uploader or the handler was harassing the shark before that. It's the same thing politics use when trying to make their opponents look bad. They'll show a very brief clip of their opponent saying something that is bound to trigger people. One of the marks of a true intellectual is someone who, when presented with the scenario I just highlighted, they ask, what did they say before and after that? What was the topic they were talking about? Same thing goes for shark events. It's the difference between understanding what is a shark bite in a shark attack. Was it provoked or unprovoked? What was the individual involved doing? Those little details matter because they present a more realistic picture of what happened. It's why when people ask me what I think about any recent shark events, I always reserve judgment until the report and/or details come out. I also say to go ask the shark scientists, as they'll usually give you a more realistic picture of what happened as well. This also goes for those who blurt out shark statistics, but don't tell you the whole story, which segues into our final section, the numbers. You can hear it now, an overly dramatic voice stating that the great white shark has attacked over 300 people. The context they won't give you is that it's 351 attacks over the span of over 450 years. And they especially won't tell you that only 59 of them have been fatal. This is why I make it a yearly habit to make a video update on the numbers of the International Shark Attack file. And I only cover the big three, because all other sharks have next to no attacks on humans. The Great Hammerhead, 18 attacks, no fatalities. The Shortfin Mako, 10 attacks, 1 fatality. The Lemon Shark, 10 attacks, no fatalities. The Blue Shark, 13 attacks, 4 fatalities. The White Tip Reef, the Black Tip Reef, the Nurse, the Sand Tiger, the Silky Shark, all 0 fatalities. But this is the type of context you won't get from a typical shark movie, YouTube video, and especially not from Shark Week or Shark Fest. What they will do is pull a sneaky trick I highlighted in my Shark Week versus Shark Fest video. The trick is, once again, not lying to you, but not telling you the whole truth. During Shark Fest of last year, in the documentary Shark Attack Files, they were investigating a shark bite from a bull shark. One of the ladies stated that shark attacks in North Carolina increased by 27%. Now, let's conduct an experiment and see if you've been paying attention in this video. Hearing that statement, what question or questions would you ask the person? Pause the video and comment down below. As for me, I know my stats. So the first question I would ask is, 27% up from what number? Why am I asking this, you say? Because I know that over the past 400 plus years, bull sharks have attacked 119 people, with 26 of them being fatal. We know all 119 didn't happen in just 1 year. So how do we break this down so we can fit 119 across the time frame of 450 years to get a yearly basis? If we use the number 450, that equals 3.8 attacks per year in order to arrive at the number 119. We'll say 4 for the sake of this video. Now that we have that as a yearly basis, what, ladies and gentlemen, is 27% of 4? 1. The reality of what that lady said was shark attacks in North Carolina increased by 1. Why then did she frame her statement using the stat of 27%? To set a narrative. That is what I'm talking about. People using numbers without the proper context to set a narrative. What's the narrative? Monster. Man-eater. Jaws. This is why the little details matter. When you go without them, people get the wrong impression of sharks. After watching this video and you go throughout your day, or night if you're a night owl, look at all the different pieces of media, art, and advertisement involving sharks. Ask yourself, what message does it send? See if it's resembling Jaws. Does it involve blood? How casual do people throw out, "I don't want to get eaten by a shark"? Now, look, I'm going to be straight with you. Most people don't have the attention span, time, or care to listen to the proper context. As tragic as that is, the best we can do is wait for our moments. Instead of just explaining, ask questions like, why do you think a shark will eat you? Or whatever other questions you guys can think of. I'm sure a number of you are familiar with the concept of leading the witness. You guys are smart folks, right? Of course you are. I've lived long enough to know that you can't please everyone. Not everyone wants to be convinced, and that Celsius is the best drink in the world. Fight me. I also know that people who want to be convinced will seek out content like this, or give you the moment you need to give them another option on how to think about sharks. Sharks aren't monsters. I believe the gentleman Shark Bites said it best. Sharks aren't killing machines, but they're not puppies either. They're sharks, and that's how I like them, as resilient, intelligent, masters of the ocean. And I'd prefer it if they stuck around for millions upon millions of years to come. This is going to be where we end things in this video. Thank you for once again giving me some of your time, and I'll see you in the next video. Until then.